Welcome to the Shipping Podcast, where you meet interesting maritime professionals sharing their passion for the shipping industry and their everyday job. I am your host. My name is Lena Gothberg. Hello, Shipping Podcast lovers. This is episode 82, and I will be introducing you to the fourth woman out of the 10 to watch for the future in the maritime industry. Her name is Thea Thorstensen. She works as an underwriter for Skuld at their headquarters in Oslo. Skuld is a marine insurance provider and a P&I club. As you will hear, Thea has studied law and then she started to work and was a claims executive at the time when we met, which was on October the 23rd, when I did my trip to Oslo. I hope you will enjoy this episode. This is our chat. Welcome to the Shipping Podcast.
Thank you.
Could you please introduce yourself?
Yes, my name is Thea Thorstensen. I work for Skuld, the P&I club here in Oslo, as a claims executive and mainly with the Italian market and the Italian ship owners and charters. I think I've been invited here because of my participation on, of course, on this list that came out during the Norse shipping event earlier this year. So I think that's what we're here to talk about today.
Yes.
Or maybe that amongst others.
Yes, amongst other things. How did you come in contact with shipping?
Since I was a little kid, basically, it comes from both ends of my family, in a sense. As I mentioned to you earlier, on my father's side in Sweden, my grandfather used to work for the big shipyard in Gothenburg, which then obviously created a bit of maritime interest in that side of the family. And then from my mother's side of the family, who are from Arendal down in south of Norway, they used to have whaling boats back in the day. So my great-grandfather was a captain, my grandfather was a captain. So I've had been from kind of both sides of the family. And then I didn't really think about it much when I was a kid that that's something I wanted to do, but it's just always been a part of the stories that I've heard and everything that's, you know, been a part of my daily life. And it was more when I was going to start to decide what I wanted to study that I kind of figured that that actually was a good fit for me. I wanted to do something commercial, something international, where I could meet people from different cultures, and I like languages, I like economics, and it turned out that that was actually the perfect industry. So
what did you study?
I went off to Plymouth University and did first a bachelor there in maritime business and maritime law. And then after that, I went off to University of Southampton to do an LLM in maritime law. So specialized a little bit towards the more legal side of it. And then straight after, I started working for Skuld. So that's been my first real job.
What do you do when you work for Skuld? I mean, if you meet someone who doesn't know anything about P&I and claims and things like, I know everything about it, but just pretend that I don't know anything.
Yes, well, I try to avoid the word insurance because that usually people won't ask any more questions because they don't think that's very interesting.
Well, I disagree.
But no, what I usually tell people is that the ship owners or the brokers call us or call me when something has gone wrong. And that's where I come into the picture. And that can be any type of thing. And P&I, I usually try to kind of compare it to the car insurance. That's liability insurance that you have for your ship. So it has nothing to do with the ship itself, like you would with your car, so and your whole machinery for your car. So, so I try to explain to them what kind of cases we come across. I mean, I deal with all type of cases in my role. So that can be both more kind of contract work for members under the charter parties, but also when they have a problem with the cargo, if there's a collision, if there's any pollution, I mean, and all the different kind of heads of cover that we deal with. And since I deal with all of them, at least it's a wide variety.
I think it's the liability that the ship owner takes upon him or herself. The shipping company's liability, that is what you insure.
That is indeed what we insure.
Just for short.
Yeah. Okay, that's the short version, yes.
Because you can be liable towards your crew and cargo and
it's a lot. It's much more than people think about immediately when they hear the word ship insurance. They always think, oh, okay, so if the ship gets damaged, but no, liability insurance is quite extensive.
I used to be a marine insurance broker, so I know a lot about that. And then I used to be an underwriter for Hull Insurance, so that is why I know a lot about the ship itself. And I agree with you, people do not think that there is such an interesting industry behind the word insurance.
No, I think people start thinking about, you know, I lost my cell phone in Bangkok and I need it back kind of type of insurance. But I mean, every single case I get is different, and it's a very varied work day and with a lot of different actors and people involved in the case, and from the smallest one to the ones in the multi-million dollar range. And it is just extremely varied, and there's so much different things that can go wrong on the oceans. And so, I mean, you never really handle the same case twice, which obviously makes it a very interesting job as well from a more development side. But I'm actually moving or changing job now, going into underwriting.
Welcome to the
to the dark side, as they say.
No, but I have always said that the best underwriters comes from claim side.
That's what they keep saying or telling me as well. So I hope that's true.
Because you won't promise everyone anything.
No, and I think also that at least it gives a good or a greater understanding of where the risks lie in practice and what actually may affect the cover. And I mean, I've dealt with these problems everywhere. I can see, you know, if I write this and this policy, what actual effect will that have on my members' operations and their...
You are the first insurance person that I actually have interviewed. Finally, I can talk about what I know a lot about. But what I mean, just thinking about Skuld is one of the P&I clubs, the international group of P&I.
Mm.
Can we talk a little bit about that? Or
yes, of course. Well, as you obviously know, there are 13 massive or big P&I clubs in the world, and they're all under this umbrella called the International Group of P&I Clubs. They're led with a secretariat out of London. And the main purpose of this, of course, is in order to be able to reinsure the risks together. So they do that under the something called the pooling agreement, where basically we pool all the claims together and share when they go over a special limit, which is now at $10 million. So every claim that's over above $10 million will then be shared amongst the different P&I clubs on a mutual basis. So it's very much part of the mutuality concept that we deal with internally in Skuld, and that gets extended to the really almost the whole world of shipping. So I'm not quite sure about the percentage, but it's way above 90% of the world tonnage that is within the IG clubs. So
yeah, because it is it's always big money and it's always huge responsibility that is insured.
So I mean, the reinsurance policies that the international group writes, I mean, it is one of the biggest reinsurance policies out there. It's a lot of money involved.
It's interesting. The other day I was invited actually at another P&I club to make a thank you speech for dinner. Thank you for dinner speech.
Oh, yeah. This sounds very Norwegian.
And I said, well, what's the new thing now? It's collaboration, transparency, and ethics. Isn't that just a description of a P&I club?
Yeah.
Which has been around for so long.
Yeah. No, it's quite fascinating. And I think also what makes it a bit or difficult to compare P&I clubs with other insurances is that they are very much led by their owners and their members. And, you know, the board and the committee is comprised by members. And, you know, they themselves kind of decide where they want to take the club. And it's not supposed to be a profit organization. It's supposed to be pretty much going in zero, at least that's, you know, the long-term aim of it. And it makes it very different from other types of company, and especially other types of insurance companies who are, you know, looking for dividends, looking for the shareholders, and, you know, building strategies on completely different kind of basis than what we do in Skuld. And it's quite interesting to see, you know, when our members are not doing well. You know, it's been some years with bad shipping markets. You know, you do feel that as well as part of the P&I club. You do feel that they see, can we do this differently? Is there other ways to organize this? You know, they are very much part of what we do, and it's a special world of insurance.
Yes, it is. Are there many females nowadays?
Yes, I think in Skuld, at least in the Oslo, no, I think worldwide in Skuld, we're 50-50, men and women, which is very good. Fortunately, that doesn't extend all the way to management, but we're hopefully about to change that a little bit. But yeah, no, there's I think a lot of it has to do with the fact that in the P&I clubs, there are a lot of lawyers. And traditionally now, you know, lawyers at least in Norway, very difficult to get into law school. You have much more women than men who gets into law school in Norway. And that kind of extends now. You're starting to see the effects of that in kind of the more work environment as well. I think in that respect, we're quite special in the shipping industry. I think we're almost more women than men in our Oslo office.
So how did your company react to you being one of the females on that 10 women to watch for the future?
They were very proud. Yes, I was a little bit embarrassed, but no, luckily my bosses and management were very supportive and very proud. So that's of course very nice.
I think it was such a great idea. I just had to jump on the opportunity to meet with you all, because I think it's such a great thing. And it's the only way to show the world that there are women.
Mm.
There are women in the industry who are just not seen or heard as much as the men, I think.
I think you're right.
So what about the future? How do you see shipping in general in the future?
Well, that's a difficult question. Now, hopefully we'll... You know, we're already seeing some signs of improvements, depending on, you know, what you're going to compare it to. But at least over the past, I think past year and two, depending a little bit also on the segments. So I think it's going in the right direction. But of course, it's going to be very interesting to see what happens more in the global economy, what happens with energy. I think it's going to be interesting to see how fossil fuels are going to be used in the future, how much renewable energy, how much that's going to affect the shipping segments. Obviously, there's still going to be a lot of transport of fossil fuels, but I think that will have an impact. And I just think it's generally, I think it's an industry that's going to be around for many, many, many years to come. And I'm not worried in that sense that I will be out of a job anytime soon. But I think we're going to be smarter. It's going to be more digitalized. It's going to be maybe more intelligent shipping. But in one sense, it's a bit difficult to say. I don't know. People keep talking about autonomous ships being... you know, on the seas in a couple of years, and then you have some others saying, nah, it's not going to be before 20 years, 30 years, and it's difficult to predict who's right on that point. I think probably it will take some time, at least for the more international transport, to get the kind of legal framework in place. So this very interesting presentations by Yara the other day about the Yara Birkeland vessel that's going to go down in... outside Brevik. And I mean, they aim to have that up in a very short amount of time, but that's, of course, very short distance, not international. They gotten the permissions needed from the Norwegian Coast Guard and the authorities. And then I think examples like that might happen very quickly. It could be a lot of them, but to see more for international shipping, I think it's still a little bit further away.
I usually ask people about that. I haven't done it in a long time now, but I used to ask everyone, what do you think about autonomous ships? And I would say it's also a generation question, because master mariners my age or older, they say, will never happen, ever. And the young generation says, when are they coming?
Yeah.
So that is a shift of mindset.
Yeah. Obviously, I don't think the technology is a problem. The technology is there. That's not going to be the hinder at all. I think
it's there already.
Yeah. So I think the only problem is how to actually make the legal frameworks and to see also cooperation between nations and especially trading nations and insurance, amongst other things, to make those kind of parts work. I think that's where the most challenges will be, and not as much. I mean, now the technical part, the design, the...
I think you're right. But I mean, if we look at the other side, like for instance, I've met someone who is digitalizing bill of lading.
Mm.
That will have a bigger impact on your job.
A lot bigger. And then you start to talk about all this blockchain technology that I understand nothing about, that I need to actually learn a little bit. But
you can listen to Deanna McDonald. I've interviewed her. She's the best to explain. Even I understood it afterwards.
Well, then maybe she's the one I need to listen to then, because I find that it is... I mean, I'm not a very kind of digital person, to be honest. And it's difficult. It is very complicated to understand, or at least for me to kind of fathom how this works in practice. But it's also very interesting, and obviously shows that a lot of what we can do today can be done in a different way that's, at least in some people's opinion, more intelligent, more safe, cheaper. I mean, there's so many so many positive sides of it, as long as we all, but I think we all first need to learn what it is, and then we can start advising about it.
I think you're right. Good idea. The shipping industry is often looked upon as the Cinderella industry. No one knows about them. What can we do to become more visible?
That's also a very good question. As I remember, sometimes when I tell people I meet that I work in shipping, they're pretty much all automatically assume that I'm on a ship working. I'm like, no, there are other parts to the shipping. Luckily, I think in Norway, it's such a big part of our economy and our day-to-day life. So I would say that the average Norwegian has a fairly good overview of what the shipping industry is and what it contains and how the different types of jobs that are available. But I think on a more general note, I think it's important to kind of explain it to the young people. And I think to get it in from early days, from school, to show them that that's an industry that, you know, requires a lot of different skills and knowledge. And that can be a very interesting workplace for a lot of people with, you know, a lot of different people as well. And of course, I mean, it's difficult to say that you should always, I mean, there's so many other industries that are interesting as well. But I think, you know, if kids hear about it, if you get more information out to the schools, and especially when it comes to more the age where they have to choose more studies or which high schools to choose, and that would be a good point to kind of to inform them a little bit more about the opportunities that are in shipping, because I think there are quite a lot. And I don't know where I would have ended up if it hadn't been for the fact that I've heard about this from my family, because I never heard about it at school, that's for sure. I mean, that was never something that was promoted as an option, or it's not seen as one of the kind of more, at least it depends of course a little bit where you are from. I mean, if you're from the west coast of Norway, you might be from a small village where half the people who live there are, you know, work at sea or at offshore platforms, or, you know, they have a completely different relationship to the whole industry. But me is from Oslo. It's just not that many of people in Oslo have a clear understanding about what it is.
It seems to be a global problem.
Yeah.
Because my theory is that we speak to each other about shipping. Mm. We love shipping. We got the bug.
We breathe it.
Yeah, we are like, everyone is talking about shipping, but we hardly ever speak to anyone outside our own ranks or our own community.
Mm.
So part of it might be our own fault.
It's a good point. I think you're right. I mean, I always have my friends who always come like, oh, Thea, have you had any fun cases lately? Tell us about the fun cases. And then I tell them. So I think my group of friends, now they all know about shipping. But that is a very, very small part of the population in Oslo and the rest of the world. So,
and that was my idea when I started the podcast. Mm. Because everyone keeps talking about, we need to become more visible. We need to have the general public understand what shipping is about and what we contribute with to society. And we can't do that by talking to ourselves.
No.
And so that is why I started to. And there are so many interesting people and there are so many interesting jobs.
Yeah, there really is. And it's also a bit of a shame because it has one of these kind of a little bit bad reputations as well. Usually, if you hear about shipping on the news, it is because it's an oil spill or because something has gone wrong or there's a ship that's breaking up somewhere, or not always. But I mean, that is a lot of what the general public would see and what they might, this is what they think about. Oh, shipping is very dirty. It's very polluting. It's bad. It's just bad. And that's
if you speak to a journalist about that, they say, well, we don't write about buildings that are not on fire. So, of course, for us to become news for a journalist, something bad has to happen. But the problem is for us that no one is talking about the good sides.
Things, exactly.
So we have a responsibility there ourselves to do that. It's interesting. I think it's very interesting. And I get a lot of feedback from students who have just started to study somewhere in the shipping industry. And they listen to the podcast and they say, wow, there are so many different jobs I could do. I realize that now it's not only the little thing that I am studying right now that could be my future career.
No, I mean, when I started my studies, I had no idea I was going to end up in a P&I club. I didn't even know what a P&I club was when I started studying. So it's kind of, you realize it after meeting a lot of different people, and, you know, once you start getting interested, you start reading the newspapers, you start reading Tradewinds and Lloyd's List and all of them, and then you understand a little bit more why the industry is and what the opportunities actually are. And it took me 3 years, I think, to figure out what a P&I club was.
And now you know.
Now I definitely know. Well, I hope so, at least they kept me for so long. So.
Did you have a role model growing up?
No, I wouldn't say that I had a role model. I didn't have a particular role model. I had a lot of people who inspired me when I was young, a lot of people in my family that I liked a lot and that were important to me. But other than that, no, I wouldn't say that I had any specific role models.
Do you feel like a role model now?
No.
I mean, you're on the list.
Yes, but I'm too young to be a role model for anything. I mean, it's... No, I really, really don't. But there was this one girl who came to me at YoungShip and said that, oh, I heard you speak at the Rederiforbundet. I thought it was great. And I've been starting to look into the world of P&I insurance because of your talk. And I mean... That makes you feel fantastic. It's a massive, massive compliment. So, in that sense, yes, I do. You know, I do feel proud. But whether or not the role model, I don't know if that's the right word.
Okay, you can just start practicing now. sooner or later, you will be one, I think. Who would you be interested in listening to? Who do you think I should meet the next time?
Ooh, that's a good question. I think it's who I would be interested to listen to.
Besides blockchain, then, because
yeah, blockchain is definitely I need to learn that. I'm guessing you're going to meet with some lawyers. I think there are some lawyers on the list because I think it would be very interesting to hear how they feel about the development and the digitalization of shipping and how they see the legal framework that they work with today, how that can and possibly will adapt in the future. I mean, that's at least something that I would find interesting, and also maybe people with more detailed knowledge about insurance in terms of how to insure these risks of the autonomous ships going forward. Well, how that will affect reinsurance, these aspects, or on a bit elevated level, such as the IG or something, and how they see it. That would be, I think, at least very interesting to listen to on one of the more kind of current topics.
Okay.
But I think it's fantastic that you meet with different people, that you get a little bit, everything from shipbuilders to insurance to legal to chartering to owners and operators, and to kind of get the lots of different points of view. I mean, that's what makes it interesting.
Yeah, I agree. And I'm so happy that there was a list. So now
it was easy.
It's much easier for me now than it was before. No, I decided that from the beginning. It should be 50-50. Mm. Female guests and male guests. And it's about 50-50. Last week it was only 47%.
So.
But are you invited to deliver speeches, as you said you were invited to?
I've done some stuff for students, mostly. And I've done a panel debate as well on behalf of school. That was also a Young Ship event on their ShipCon, which was last year. And I remember how it was when I was young and you started to get into the shipping. I didn't know very many people who worked in shipping, so I used a little bit the YoungShip network. I thought that was a fantastic possibility to get access to people and different companies and to understand what the companies were doing and to meet other people in the shipping industry. Since I didn't know that many, I didn't have anyone to kind of clone myself with. And I just thought that YoungShip did a fantastic work back then. I mean, today, yes, we have so many stuff going on. So I unfortunately don't have time to join so many of the YoungShip things. And I know a lot of people now. So, but I think for young people who are just starting in the industry, I think it's a fantastic organization. And it really provides the opportunity for young people to meet other people working in the shipping industry and to kind of work together and to get ideas off each other and bounce stuff off. And I mean, really... I mean, it's a people's business. It's a lot about also connections, but it's about meeting people, discussing ideas, developing. I mean, I think it is very important to meet different people. And so I've been always kind of said to YoungShip that I'll be more than happy to assist.
Have you ever felt like this is a male industry? Have you ever felt that feeling? I wanted to ask because I was approached by some even younger women. Mm. In other parts of the world, who says that they find it. I mean, we're right in that hashtag Me Too, which is going around the world. But I was approached by some young, really young ladies, and they said, it's hard to be a woman in a man's world.
Yeah.
Have you ever felt that?
No, I can't say that I have, to be honest. And I do... I also like working with men. I think that's might have something to do with it. So I don't think about it that much. And obviously, when I go and I travel a lot for work and I go to meetings, I tend to be the only female in the meetings. But I traveled a lot to south of Europe, where I think there's still a bit larger gap on how many women are involved in, especially the insurance part of the industry. But then again, I sit in my office and I'm surrounded by women. So, and I never felt that it's been a problem. I never felt that it's stopped me somehow in making me or allowing me to do what I want, or rather the opposite, to be honest. So I've never seen it as a problem or any type of obstacle.
Thank you. I promised her that I would ask some young women in this part of the world how they felt about that.
Yeah.
Thank you, Thea. Thank you very much for participating.
You're welcome.
Thank you
so much
time.
For having me.
You're always welcome. Thank you, Thea. I felt energized after having met with you. I think you're a great role model, so you probably have to live with that. Have you also noticed that there are so many more visible women nowadays in the maritime industry? I don't know if it's only me that sees them. I mean, there was an all-female panel at CMA this year, the Connecticut Maritime Association, in March. That has never happened before. I participated in an all-female webinar, a panel, to discuss why there are so few women in the maritime industry. That has never happened before. There's so many times nowadays that I write for the first time ever. And I think it's great. I'm sure we will make a difference. And we have only started to see this yet. The next guest in the shipping podcast is the fifth woman out of the 10. I think it's interesting to hear and compare what they are saying, don't you? So it's only 18 episodes until 100. Maybe I need to start to plan what to do for the 100th episode. Do you think I should do any more after that? Or will 100 episodes be enough? Send me some feedback on that. I don't know. Are you tired of listening to this? Or do you want to hear more? I have so many ideas, as always, on how I could continue this journey as a podcaster. But I'm interested to hear what you, the listeners, think. I do get feedback on my questions. I just forgot to tell you all about it. I got a wonderful email from someone who had binge-listened on a road trip. And he didn't think that I should change anything. Or if I wanted to change something, that would be maybe to do some interviews online. But I think part of the secret sauce here is to sit down and have a chat and forget about the microphone. But I don't know. It could be worth a try. Maybe I could get some even more interesting guests on board then. But I like my traveling. So, yeah, input on that, please. Did you see in the news that the autonomous ships is now becoming a reality? It's so interesting. The future is happening now, and I think that we should be a part of it. We should decide how we want the future for the shipping industry to be like. You can't do that if you sit still and just refuse to listen or to try and understand what's happening. I think I have made myself clear when it comes to that. But on the other hand, you never know if the people that ought to listen to my podcast do that, or if it's only the ones that agree with me, like I always agree with my guests. That's why you need to spread the word for me. We need more people to listen to the shipping podcast. I'm on a crusade here, and you are the ones that can help me. So, until the next time, from me to you, over and out. Thank you for listening to the Shipping Podcast. Don't forget to tell everyone that you meet that there is a shipping podcast available and that they should download it and listen to the maritime professionals who are sharing their passion for the shipping industry.